Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's old as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there is pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory. Name, you give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Around the glossy sea. Good morning. Welcome to Bethany Church. My name is Seth Daly. Here are some announcements. Tuesday, November 8th, tune in for 30 to 30 pieces of silver, all online time of Bible and prayer, 7 p.m. presenter Damon Weary and Kim Daly. Access Facebook Bethany Columbia, November 8th. Wednesday, November 9th, soul dinner here at Bethany Sister, 7 p.m., soul social islands for adult regulation. Thursday, November 10th, Ladies Supper Club meets at 6:30 p.m. at Spikes in Millstock, 4 East Washington Street. Sunday, November 13th, Town Hall meeting at Bethany about disaffiliation from the United Methodist Church is at 11 a.m. Monday, November 14th, Trustees meeting at 6:30 p.m. Wednesday, November 16th, new book club at Bethany Lunch will be provided. Book The Unfinished Gift by Dane Welsh. Thursday, November 17th, church council meeting at 6:30 p.m. Saturday, November 19th, Faith Gathering at Bethany, 4 p.m. Please sign up on the sign-up sheet on the connections table located outside the sanctuary. Please bring a side dish and our dessert to Faith Gathering. Our friends from East St. Louis Trinity United Methodist Church will join us. Thank you. Enjoy worship.
Good morning. The Lord be with you. Amen. Let us pray. O great and mighty God of creation and lover of our souls, we thank you again for the day that you have given us to live. And truly we can say this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. In all that life brings, Lord, you have been good. We come together today with many different needs and from a number of different experiences, and yet we all come to you with that one need of keeping a meaningful relationship with you and with each other that will result in a peace that passes all understanding. And we ask for grace in this hour and for help to those who are on our hearts and on our minds. We pray collectively for our congregation, that we may live out the plan that you have for us in this community. We pray that your transforming power will be made known throughout the area where we live. We pray for the sick and for the disheartened, for the weak and the infirm. We pray that you grant them healing, strength, peace, and joy, and that they might know that you are the Lord of love, and they would be able to function in the way that you desire, and it would be all to your glory and honor. For the challenges that are before us, O Lord, we pray that you would grant us wisdom to discern your will and the courage to carry it out. Help us to be willing to give of ourselves to you, so that our hearts would rejoice in the salvation of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May we remain today in an attitude of worship, so that in all we do, we may develop teachable spirits and be ready and sufficiently humble to react appropriately to any teachings, any corrections, training in righteousness that we may receive. Keep us looking to Jesus and growing in grace. For it's in the Lord's name that we pray. Amen.
Good morning, Bethany boys and girls. So how many of you ever used one of these before? Oh, come on, you had to have archery class in PE. Yes, I did. I know some of you have used them to hunt with. Some of them used as toys, which this one is. This one's actually a pretty fancy one. Let me show it to you. I'm going to have to put down the mic, though. This is a Nerf one. Easy loader. Doesn't get much easier than that, right? Stick the arrow in. Pull back. It even, I'm trying to look here. It even lights up. So what do you think? Should I give it a whirl and shoot it? Oh yeah, let's see. Oh, nope. I better shoot it this way. Maybe I'll just shoot it over there. Let's see how far it goes. Oh, not bad for a toy, is it? So, you know, I just shot that. Was that a good shot? Kind of, I really wasn't aiming at anything, was I? No, nothing at all. And did you know that, oops, better get my bike back, sorry. Did you know that some people are like that? They don't have a goal or a target, just like I didn't have a goal or target over there, right? They just kind of walk through life aimlessly. But the Bible has something to say about that. It tells you what your target should be. Let me read it to you. This is actually from last week, but it's 2 Corinthians 5, verses 9 and 10. It goes like this. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we are at home in the body or away from it. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each of us may receive what is due us for the things done while in the body, whether good or bad. Our target, right there, pleasing God each and every moment of each and every day. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we just ask that you be with us. Help us to reach our target and just make your hands upon us. Show us grace and mercy. We just ask this all in your name. Amen.
Thank you so much to Zach Daly for announcements. For one of our retired pastors, we have Gary Mosman, Ron Chase, and Howard Salee. That was Reverend Howard Salee opening us and setting the tone with prayer. And then Susan Hykus with her children's message. And timing is everything, and this isn't planned, but I listened to ABC. It's a band from a long time ago, their greatest hits. And they have a song all about an arrow and shooting an arrow. There you go. Who knew? Want to give a word behind the scenes and a thank you to all those who turned around the church very quickly from yesterday to today. Let me explain. There was a wedding here yesterday, the celebration of Katie Young and Tim Bromley getting married, and then in the aftermath of all the wedding and that kind of thing, a bunch of our folks here at the church completely turned around the church building to get it ready for worship. There's a time and a place for everything. I can only imagine that all the Bromleys, all the Youngs and their friends are a happy tired this morning. And we celebrate with all of you. So we continue on in service. A way that you can connect with Bethany at your speed is to type in connect.bethanyonthehill.org. That's connect.bethanyonthehill.org. For those online, as well as those joining us in sanctuary, we are Bethany Church, located in Columbia, Illinois. My name is Alan Miller. I'm your pastor. We invite you to like, to comment, to flash up emojis, to share, to check in. And let out a woo if there's something that connects with you, either online or especially in sanctuary. As we continue in service, we come to the time of sharing our vision and of our mission. Our vision is to see changed lives for Jesus Christ. That's what we do. And how we do it, the follow-through, is see changed lives for Jesus Christ through times of worship, discipleship, and service. We do this to glorify God. As we continue in service, we come to the time of our offering. Flashing on the screen or on the wall, you will see the various ways to give to the ministries and the teachings and the very life found within Bethany Church. And I just offer a heartfelt thank you for your support on that. For those online, as well as those here in sanctuary, it is a Communion Sunday. In the United Methodist Church, the first Sunday of every month is a Communion Sunday. We are on November the 6th today. And so I invite those who are online to gather up bread or crackers or some food item to represent the body of Christ, and invite people to also gather up a drink item or juice to represent the blood of Christ. And just in short time, we will begin with the service of Holy Communion. Back in the first century, Jesus deeply desired to have a meal with his disciples. And at a certain point in the meal, he took the bread and the cup and gave them brand new and extraordinary meaning. He took the bread, lifted it up, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, lifted it up, and pronounced a brand new teaching for everyone to hear. This is my blood poured out for you and for many other people for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so for those who are worshiping with us online, I invite you to take your bread item or your food item and your drink item that represent the body and the blood of Christ, and let us receive together the body of Christ broken for us, the blood of Christ shed for us. As we continue with communion service in-house, Judy Tuttle, our usher, will lead you forward from the back to the front. You'll be invited to come forward, to stand or kneel at the altar rail to receive the bread wafer and the cup in your time. Take all the time that you need. Know that it's an open communion table. There's no need for special. It's just a willingness to receive what God wants one of us. So that I will be off to the side to pray with anyone who wants a time of. We'll play some music. Come, all things are ready. Judy will lead you forward. Thank you. everyone to stand both online and in sanctuary as we prepare to receive this morning's scripture. Some music will lead us in. Ah, the rain part still doesn't fit. You know, farmers need rain at a certain time. You know, sometimes farmers get enough rain in one field and another field next to it, they don't get enough. You've heard those stories before, but the sun part always fits. All the world is waiting for the sun, amen? We adapt that as Jesus Christ. We continue on in the depths of 2 Corinthians. We're in parts of chapter 7 and 8 this morning. Here's a reading of God's word. Because we have these promises, dear friends, let us cleanse ourselves from everything that can defile our body or spirit, and let us work toward complete holiness because we fear God. Please open your hearts to us. We have not done wrong to anyone, nor led anyone astray, nor taken advantage of anyone. I'm not saying this to condemn you. I said before that you are in our hearts, and we live or die together with you. I have the highest confidence in you, and I take great pride in you. You have greatly encouraged me and made me happy despite all our troubles. When we arrived in Macedonia, northern Greece, there was no rest for us. We faced conflict from every direction, with battles on the outside and fear on the inside. But God, who encourages those who are discouraged, encouraged us by the arrival of Titus. His presence was a joy, but so was the news he brought of the encouragement he received from you. When he told us how much you longed to see me and how sorry you are for what happened and how loyal you are to me, I was filled with joy. I'm not sorry that I sent that severe letter to you, though I was sorry at first, for I know it was painful to you for a little while. Now I'm glad I sent it, not because it hurt you, but because the pain caused you to repent and change your ways. It was the kind of sorrow God wants his people to have, so you are not harmed by us in any way. For the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads us away from sin and results in salvation, or Jesus. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow, but worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. Just see what this godly sorrow produced in you, such earnestness, such concern to clear yourself, such indignation, such alarm, such longing to see me, such zeal, and such a readiness to punish wrongdoers. You show that you have done everything necessary to make things right. My purpose then was not to write about who did the wrong or who was wronged. I wrote to you so that in the sight of God, you could see for yourselves how loyal you are to us. We have been greatly encouraged by this. In addition to our own encouragement, we were specifically delighted to see how happy Titus was about the way all of you welcomed him and set his mind at ease. I had told him how proud I was of you, and you didn't disappoint me. I've always told you the truth, and now my boasting to Titus has also proved true. Now he cares for you more than ever when he remembers the way all you obeyed him and welcomed him with such fear and deep respect. I am very happy now because I have complete confidence in you. Now I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters, what God in his kindness has done through the churches in Macedonia, northern Greece. They're being tested by many troubles, and they're very poor, but they are also filled with abundant joy, which has overflowed in rich generosity. For I can testify that they gave not only what they could afford, but far more, and they did it of their own free will. They begged us again and again for the privilege of sharing in the gift for the believers in Jerusalem. They even did more than we had hoped, for their first action was to give themselves to the Lord and to us, just as God wanted them to do. So we have urged Titus, who encouraged your living in the first place, to return to you and encourage you to finish this ministry of giving. Since you excel in so many ways, your faith, your gifted speakers, your knowledge, your enthusiasm, and your love from us, I want you to excel also in this gracious act of giving. I'm not commanding you to do this, but I am testing how genuine your love is by comparing it with the eagerness of the other churches. It's the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. You ever hear the expression, get with it, or get with the program? It's all about with. I am on a campaign on the heels of Tuesday and all the madness and mayhem that's going to happen with mid-year elections. The campaign of the wonders of with. With means in place together and doing something together. Get with it. It sounds like the Christian community, whether you're looking at the wild, wily place of Corinth back in the first century or whether you're looking at today. Big ideas for our time together will flash on the screen or appear on the wall. Purify, reverence for God, godly comfort and sorrow, pronounced generosity, and excel in everything, including giving. Right in front of our scripture, 2 Corinthians 6, Paul basically says, in the throes of following Jesus and doing church, you got to take it one day at a time. Christian artist Jeremy Camp puts it this day, one day at a time, I know I will carry on. I've been burned out, broken, torn down, torn out, and all these things, I will press on. So will we, Jeremy Camp. So will we. 2 Corinthians 7, verse 1. Because we have these promises, dear friends, let us cleanse ourselves from everything that can defile our body or spirit. And let us work towards complete purity because we fear or reverence, respect God. The big idea is to purify, reverence for God. Clean things up. We are family, brothers, sisters, me. Clean things up. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Do good. Engage in the practice of ministry, of serving in the name of Jesus. Pastor, will we always get it right? No. But we got to make the effort and try to serve. And if we make a mess of it, we make corrections and we do it again. And we continue to serve. Have you ever known a time in a church where something didn't go quite right or it went wrong? You probably have your stories. Post those online. I'm just kidding. Don't do that. Unless you want to do that. But the idea is to strive to be Christ-like. Our bishop in the United Methodist Church of the Illinois Great Rivers Conference has said repeatedly in meetings as well as in public that he is going to conduct himself in a Christ-like manner. We take our lead from him to strive to be Christ-like. Is it easy? Not always. Verse 2, please open your hearts. Open your hearts to us. We have not done wrong to anyone. We haven't led anyone astray. We haven't taken advantage of anyone. Open your hearts. Part of opening your heart, have you done wrong to someone? Have you led someone astray? Have you taken advantage of someone? If you have, echo a little Harold Jenkins and tell them, I'm so sorry that I did you wrong. That's the basis of every country music song on planet Earth, isn't it? I'm so sorry that I did you wrong. Build or repair the relationship. Open your heart. Be honest and tell the truth. Veritas, Latin for truth. You can feel the weight and the importance of truth. And as you declare the truth, you got to choose what you're going to do. Are you going to confront someone or are you going to condemn them? If you confront them, you have a dialogue, you have a conversation, and it might get heated versus what your favorite sports team is and what team really stinks to where you are arguing. But if you condemn someone, you lash out them, you stomp on them like WWF or WWE, take your pick. Condemn, you destroy someone, you dub them unforgiven. We never want to do that. That's the devil's territory. The Bible tells us that the devil, the evil one, comes to steal and kill and destroy. We don't want to get wrapped up in that. Instead, we want to confront. We want to build the relationship and restore the relationship. Open our hearts, be honest, and speak the truth. Veritas. Verses 3 and 4. I'm not saying this to condemn you. For I said before that you're in our hearts forever. We live or die with you. I have the highest confidence in you. Go team! And my pride in you is really great. You have greatly encouraged me. You have made me happy despite all of the troubles that we have been through. Can you relate to the scripture or what? In your personal life? In the church? In our community? And so on. The bottom line is that there's to be no condemnation. Get rid of condemnation and look at building the relationship. Paul says to these people in the wildest place on earth, a church planted in Corinth is kind of like Sojay down the road, or Brooklyn or Venice, Illinois, if you know the area, that you are in our hearts, that that's up there right with being with someone. And I give you again the wonder of with, being in place together and doing something together. That's when life gets really rich and meaningful, and it truly honors God, and we're Christ-like. In Scripture, you are together in our hearts forever. This isn't Joni loves Chachi for a little while, some happy days. We're talking in our hearts forever. That's the commitment. Paul says, Corinthian church, I'm going to ride or die with you. I am with you. Even though I get mad at you and I blast you from time to time, and I really don't want to chew you out, but I'm going to chew you out. That's getting ahead of the story. The church holds together even in the odd spaces, and the church holds together even in the flux, where you don't know and when you're going to land. There are troubles, Paul says, outlined in the Scriptures, aimed at the Corinthian church, as well as general troubles. In the world of bookstores and online sales of books, there's an author named M. Scott Peck, and he gives us these statements. Life is hard. Life is difficult. Life is unfair. There are no easy answers. He writes these bold statements, short statements, compact statements in all of his books. The road less traveled, further along the road less traveled and beyond. And part of my sarcastic nature says the only book he hasn't written is the end of the road, the very last book. It's true, right? Life is difficult. It's hard. It's unfair. Life is complex, and there are no easy answers. There is trouble. And in Scripture, in the midst of that, God is at work in the Corinthians. In the midst of their struggles, their troubles, when Paul wants to blast them to get them back on the right track, in the midst of all of it, they are seeing some changed lives for Jesus Christ, all to the glory of God. 2 Corinthians 7, verse 5, when we arrived in Macedonia, northern Greece, there was no rest for us. Outside, there was conflict from every direction, and inside, we were filled with fear. Paul's like, get this. We left Corinth, southern Greece, and we went to northern Greece, the north side. And there was pushback and opposition in the north side more than in Corinth. You know, up north where the cities don't get no sleep, Philippi, Thessalonica, Pella, and others, where there's a long history of fighting in the streets, people being bloodstained, bloodshed, and hoods devastated. And in the midst of that, Jesus is at work. Macedonia, the north side, is even wilder than Corinth on the south side. Who knew? Now we know. Verses 6 and 7. But God, who encourages those who are discouraged, sent us encouragement through Titus. Titus arrived. His presence was a joy, and so was the news he brought of the encouragement he received from you. When he told me how much you were looking forward to my visit, and how sorry you were about what happened, and how loyal your love is for me, I was filled with joy. Titus is another member of the early church action team, the gang. Titus is a good follower of Jesus Christ. And he brings several things to the table, including joy. The people in Corinth have joy for Titus. Titus has joy for them. Paul has joy for Titus. It's a joy fest, if you will, with or without a radio station. Titus is a difference maker. He's a way maker in the Corinthian church. He's a faithful worker for Jesus, and he has a really unique body of work. He had done a lot of work in the Cretan church on the island of Crete, a Greek island right in the Mediterranean Sea, the Great Sea. The book of Titus in the Bible is set in Crete later in the New Testament. The people of Crete are Cretans. To be called a Cretan in the ancient world, as maybe now as well, is a slam, a sneer, an insult. To be a Cretan was to be a liar, a thief, a scoundrel, sketchy or super sketchy, gritty, and rough. These aren't people that are going to be called in to do a photo shoot for GQ magazine or website. But in the midst of that, Titus's ministry with the Cretans are included back in the birth of the church known as the Day of Pentecost. You remember the story in Acts chapter 2? It's obscure, but it's in verse 11, where Peter is preaching. He's been filled with the Holy Spirit. He's leading the people. Some of the people are wondering if they're all drunk because they're all filled with the Spirit and speaking different languages. Everybody understands each other. And Peter says these words, "Here we all are, Parthians, Elamites, Cretans, and Arabs, people speaking about the wonderful things God has done. Marvel over how God works in the Corinthians, the Cretans, and beyond. Verses 8 and 9, I'm no longer sorry that I sent that letter to you, says Paul. I was sorry for a time, for I know it was painful for you for a little while. Now I'm glad I sent it, not because it hurt you, but because the pain caused you to have remorse and change your ways. It was the kind of sorrow God wants his people to have, so you were not harmed by this in any way. The big idea is godly comfort and sorrow. Paul's like, I had to be tough on you. I had to give you the business because you weren't following, you weren't obeying the God. And it wasn't just an accidental, oh, excuse me, I did it once. It was repeat offender to where you were deliberately and habitually completely following, not following God and disobeying God. I had to straighten you out. But church, it's much better like that. You're not like that anymore. You're not disobedient. I'm here to pump you up. You're developing your focus on better things now in your life. You're putting your focus on Jesus Christ. I'm thankful and proud for you. Paul communicates the sense that we can't do this without you. And godly comfort and sorrow, especially godly sorrow, God works on us or God works us over, all for the good and the glory of God. But in the midst of that, there's this purification process that goes back to the Old Testament times where you scour someone with scouring pads, almost literally, to get them completely clean and get rid of the defilement and the dirt and the grime and the junk. Before Paul was proud of the church, he had to chew out the church. It was painful and a reality check. And here, very briefly, Paul kind of references a letter that unfortunately we don't have in the Bible. And we don't know what he said to these wayward Corinthians and the Corinthian church once again. But he calls them out. He chews them out. You ever been chewed out? You're like, every day, pastor. You should know my story. It isn't fun. It's painful. I was a manager at Ruby Tuesday restaurants in Nashville, Tennessee as a young adult. I was number 5 on the manager team. Most nights as a number 5 manager out of 5 managers resembled a 5-on-3 St. Louis Blues hockey power play. And we were the 3. And the other people, all the people in the restaurant who were eating were the 5. Our store was hopping, but we were going through growing pains. We were breaking sales records left and right. We were a $1.5 million sales dollar store and headed towards $2 million. Rose up to be manager number 4, got chewed out again. Rose up to be manager number 3, middle manager, literally 2 above me, 2 below me, got chewed out again. The top manager, the general manager, Brian, he got chewed out by the DO, the director of operations. Everyone gets chewed out, right? It's not fun when you get chewed out. It's painful. And that's how Paul's like, you know what? I chewed you out. I really didn't want to chew you out. But I chewed you out because it's for your own good to advance the cause of Jesus Christ, for you to express remorse that you're sorry, not that you got caught, but that you did the wrong thing in the beginning, and now you can go in this new direction with God. Get going. Verse 10, for God can use sorrow in our lives, like that sorrow of not following God, to help us turn away from sin and seek salvation known as Jesus Christ. We will never regret that kind of sorrow, but sorrow without repentance is a kind that results in death. And as a scripture you saw on the wall or on your screen, that's all about spiritual death, that loss of connection, that loss of relationship with God and Jesus Christ. Whether it's a fast fade or a slow fade, it doesn't have to be that way. You can replace any spiritual death with spiritual life. Verse 11, just see what this godly sorrow produced in you. Such earnestness, concern to clear yourselves, indignation, alarm, longing to see me, such zeal, and a readiness to punish the wrongdoers. Godly sorrow produced in you. You've done your damage control, and now you're doing the right thing. The wrongs have been righted, and you're following Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 7, verses 12 to 16, quickly summarized. My purpose wasn't to write about those who did wrong or who was wronged. I wrote to you so that in the sight of God, you could show how much you really do care. We have been encouraged by this. In addition, we're happy because Titus is happy. You welcomed him. You set his mind at ease. He, in turn, cares for you more than he ever did. You listen to him and welcome him with great respect. Way to go, church. There's no scorekeeping. could you imagine a scenario this coming Tuesday where there's no scorekeeping with the elections, but just people caring for one another? What about in the Church of Jesus Christ? Not Bethany Church, but another church, right? It's always easy to posit that on another church, but let's look at ourselves as well, to where we put our best foot forward and we care for one another. And there's no scorekeeping for those who have wronged or those who have done the wrong or been wronged. Instead, echo that Harold Jenkins, "I'm so sorry that I did you wrong." Can you hear the Conway Twitty? Who knew Conway Twitty theologically would help us this morning, right? It's all about caring for each other and being sorry for doing wrong. That's essentially what Paul is saying as we head into 2 Corinthians chapter 8. And then you got to mark the date and mark the time. Paul is very happy. Then he proceeds to take a tactic that's not really advised, but it's biblical. To help one church, he talks about another church, like in Jerseyville or in Onarga or some other church other than Columbia Bethany. 2 Corinthians 8, verse 1, very happy, Paul says, "Now I want to tell you, dear friends, what God in his kindness has done in the churches in Macedonia, the north side. Though they have been going through much trouble and hard times, their wonderful joy and deep poverty have overflowed in rich generosity." Big idea, pronounced generosity. Paul's desire is to see very notable financial generosity. And the way he does this is to talk about another church. Now I ask you, does that help? Or is this going to massively backfire? Let's see. Paul proceeds to talk about the other churches to the Corinthian church. The churches Paul talks about are TTUN, the teams up north. They are the rough places to plant a church. Life on the north side, verses 3 to 5. "For I can testify that they gave not only what they could afford, but they gave far more, and they gave of their own free will. They begged us again and again for the gracious privilege to give even more to the church in Jerusalem. Best of all, they went beyond our highest hopes, for their first action was to dedicate themselves to the Lord and to us for whatever direction God might give them." The people open themselves to the direction that God gives them, and then they give. You may remember in the Bible, or you can find it in the Bible, in the New Testament, in one of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, the story of Jesus and the rich young ruler. The rich young ruler has it all together. He's a bag of chips and all of that. He's got swagger and that kind of thing that the kids say, and he wants eternal life. And Jesus says, for you specifically to have eternal life, give away everything. Sell everything off and give the proceeds to the poor and give everything away. And sadly, the rich young ruler walks away because he can't part with everything and give everything away. Now, when it comes to financial giving, there aren't too many stories like this in the real world or even elsewhere in the Bible where Jesus or God says, give everything away. Thank God, right? Makes it easier to operate a church and to move forward. But we are to give the Lord what the Lord requires, and that's our tithes and our offerings. More about that in a moment. 10% to God first and more. Verses 6 and 7, 2 Corinthians 8. "So we've urged Titus, who encouraged your giving in the first place, to return to you and encourage you to complete your share, Corinthian church, in this ministry of giving. Since you excel in so many other ways, you have such faith, you have such eloquent speakers, you have knowledge, enthusiasm, and love for us. Now we want you to excel in this ministry of giving." Big idea, excel in everything, including giving. This ministry of giving. It takes money to do ministry. And to set everyone's minds at ease, including mine, no coercion, no forcing. Guido or Greta won't show up at your door and say, "You gotta give!" No, the church is voluntary. It's free will. There's an open invitation to partner with the church and to give financially, to see changed lives for Jesus Christ through times of worship, discipleship, and service, and beyond. It's really a limitless invitation in Bethany Church to give of tithes and offerings. Jesus' instruction on money is to give cheerfully and give generously. There you go, straight from the source, the Son of God. All the world is waiting for the Son. Verse 8, "I'm not saying you must do it, even though the other churches are eager to do it." Looking at you, Macedonia, north side. "This is the one way to prove that your love is real." We teach in our membership classes, Christians were called to generously give support to God's work in this world. For most Christians, our income's in the form of money, so we give money. We give money to God for two primary reasons. One, to be obedient to God. We do this by physically demonstrating that He is truly the Lord or the authority of our lives. The sacrifice of giving a portion of our income is a powerful gesture and serves to remind us and testify to others that God is first in our life. And number two, we participate with God in the work of the church. How much should Christians give? I've heard that question year after year for 25 years as a pastor. The teaching goes, the standard contribution in the Bible is the tithe, or 10%. Offerings are given on top of that. Jesus issues no specific additional instructions about giving other than to give cheerfully and generously. In almost every instruction about tithing or giving in the Bible, God makes sure to add how much we'll be blessed when we give generously. The Bible encourages us to test God concerning tithes and offerings. Then in the last book in the Old Testament, Malachi, we find these words, "Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so there'll be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord Almighty, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you do not have enough room to take it in. Try it. Let me prove it to you." So we give to the Lord, and we give to advance the cause of Jesus Christ, partly because all the world is waiting for the Son, known as Jesus Christ. And we do a tremendous service to the church and the community as we continue to give generously financially. David Gusick, a Bible scholar, reflects, in Scripture, Paul's not encouraging a fundraising competition between the churches of Macedonia, north side, and Corinth, south side. When you see a believer who is truly generous, a great work of God has been done in their hearts, giving is getting involved. Thank you, David Gusick. Take the big ideas with you today. Purify. Reverence for God. Clean up whatever needs cleaning up. Amen. Godly comfort and sorrow. The importance of pronounced generosity. And excel in everything in the life of the church, including financial giving. So let's get with it. The idea of without you? No. There's a sense that we can't do this without you. Specifically, we can't do this without you, God. We can't do this without you, Jesus. And we can't do this without you, church. Every person matters. And you're like, Pastor, even so-and-so? Yes, even so-and-so matters. God love them. We need to be with each other to move the church forward. Join me as we continue on this fall in marveling over the wonders of with, in place together and doing something together, all to the glory of God. Let's get with it. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you for opportunities that we have to connect with one another, to be with one another, to love one another and support each other. We look for the way that you help us through the and troubles, and problems, and travails. We're mindful of your presence and your goodness. We're mindful of how things begin to change, things begin to turn into shuva as we turn back to Jesus Christ. May we be mindful of his love, resilience, and his forgiveness for all of us on this Communion Sunday. We pray, Lord God, that we can extend love and patience and forgiveness to those around us who so desperately need it. Continue to do your work in us as a faith community, in our individual lives, in our families, and even as a nation, all to your glory. And now, mindful that God is looking for our response, we pray together the words of the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us both online and in sanctuary here at Bethany Church. A couple of things that we have coming up are our town hall meeting that's going to be next Sunday, 11 a.m., to talk about the prospect of disaffiliation from the United Methodist Church. We'll have people to speak to that more to answer your questions, but long story short, research committee gave the recommendation to the church council after they did all their due diligence and work about the decision is to disaffiliate from the United Methodist Church. The church council, in turn, is turning that recommendation over towards the church. There will not be a vote next Sunday. It's just a conversation, a meeting, dialogue, and then further down the line, our district superintendent with the connectional nature of the United Methodist Church will set a date and a potential vote. So that's where we are with that. Let me know as you have more questions about that. On a much different note, you can sign up on the sign-up sheet for those in person on the connections table for Thanksgiving, where our friends from East St. Louis Trinity United Methodist Church will be our guests for 4 p.m. Saturday, November 19th. I invite everyone to stand both online and in person, and let's sing together as we continue to worship. Thank you so much for being here, both online and in sanctuary. We invite you to join us again. Have a good week. See you next week.